Good afternoon, welcome to EdSat Network. Friend, as you know, this week we have organized a series of lectures on ancient Indian history and particularly the rise of Magad and Mauryan Empire. Rise of Magad is an important milestone when we consider in the annals of history, and in fact it gave as a considered as a turning point. There are several factors which helped in the rise of Magad and the will of the leaders and the or what he faced while fighting and while framing a strategy, and there were very, you can say, very thought of plan what the Magad followed and fight with the other Janpadas which were powerful at that time, and there were 16 Mahajanpada. They all have strength and power to overcome the central power, but how the Magad formed the strategy and finally emerged as a superpower and gave laid foundation of the empire. So we'll talk about the different aspect, different dimension of Magad, and for discussion on this very topic, we have in the studio an eminent scholar on this topic, Dr. Anand Vardhan. Presently, he is a senior faculty in Delhi Institute of Heritage Research and Management, and written many books. The few of them are Discovering Indian Museology, History and Heritage Through Maps, Arena of Indian Museum, and presently also he is looking after how rural heritage of Magad can be put into the place. So I think his knowledge and experience will help us to understand the rise of Magad in a right way, and will give an insight and perspective to understand the rise of Magad. Welcome, sir.
Thank you very much. The significance of Magad is undoubtedly well known in respect to state formation in India. Generally, it is said that the role that Greek as a state played in entire European history, the similar role was played by Magadha in the history of entire Asia. And this is a very significant point, that out of 16 Mahajanpadas, all aspiring to become the most prominent kingdom and the most powerful kingdom of their own era, it was Magad who was finally successful in integrating the country and extending its political sway right from Rajagrih and Pataliputra up to the region of Gandhar and Kamboj. So we have to discuss some of the very significant, very important points related to the history of Magad, and in this respect, what is important for us to know that how the role of a state was changing in 6th century BC India. We know that in later Vedic period, there had taken place migration from the region of Saraswati and Drishadavati river, from the region of modern day Haryana, Rajasthan and western Uttar Pradesh to the region of North Bihar. And there is a very interesting story in Satpath Brahman, that is of Videh Madhav, who had finally settled in the region of North Bihar with the Aryan group. And this was how the group of Aryans had migrated and settled in the region of North Bihar. At that time, Magadha was dominated by non-Aryan tribes, and we find reference of Magadha, of course, first time in Atharva Veda, where it has been described that Magadha belongs to Kirats, and the term itself, Magadha, that has also been used in respect to the community which was living in an area which was covered by forests and hills. Basically, Magadha, this term itself denotes to a hilly area, a an area that is covered by thick forest, and the various names which we find described in later Vedic literature as well as Buddhist and Jain literature, they ascertain this fact that Magadha was full of small hills and had a wide forest cover. It was probably after the penetration of Vedic Aryans that the area became very much significant in respect of agriculture, and a monarchical state was founded in this region. We will have to understand the then political situation. We know that during later Vedic period, people were actually been part of Jan. We find reference of several Jan means tribal communities like Srinjaya, Bharat, Tritsu, Kuru, Puru. Several names have been described in Vedic literature. But then we find that monarchical states started emerging in 6th century BC India, and we have very frequent references of those kingdoms. Especially the term Janpad has been used numerously in the literature of this particular period. Janpad as a term is very important because it makes explicit that the area which was which had settled villages and later on where emerged townships also, Janpadanughyat, where people had already established their authority and control, that was called a Janpad. In Buddhist literature, this is very important to know that in Buddhist literature, especially in Anguttara Nikaya, we get reference of 16 Mahajanpadas. This term again is very, very important because Maha has been added to it in adjectival sense, means large territories which were being ruled by, you know, independent sovereign rulers. Especially the description of Magadha in this respect is very important, because the area where Magadha existed, that has been called the Prachya Desh, means the eastern region of the country. And in eastern region itself, there were several states. Ang was one very important state that was east towards the east of Magadha, and then Magadh was one important monarchical state. Apart from that, we get reference of Kashi, that is modern Varanasi, and then Kosala, which had the capital at Sravasti. Buddhist text describe is as Savatthi, and then we have Vatsa kingdom, that was the area around Allahabad. So this important, this region which we can term as middle Gangetic plain, that became significant in context of the rise of the territorial monarchical states. Apart from several oligarchic states which have been described as Ganarajya. So we get description of 16 Mahajanpadas, and we also get reference of several Ganarajyas which can be termed as clan oligarchies. Jain texts also describe about the 16 Mahajanpadas. However, their description is little different from the description we find in Anguttara Nikaya. Very especially, Jain text, which we know as Bhagavati Sutra, describes in detail about about the 16 Mahajanpadas, and in this regard we get references of some of the regions of the area beyond Vindhya mountain. So of course Jain reference is of later period, and historians generally rely upon the reference that we find in Anguttara Nikaya. So 16 Mahajanpadas basically covered the region right from Kamboj, that is now part of Central Asia, part of Central Asia, Tajikistan. It touched the boundary of Tajikistan. It was in the northwestern towards northwestern direction of the Gandhara. Gandhara was another important janpat. We find that covered the region of modern days Pakistan and Kashmir. This was another Mahajanpat that has been mentioned. Then we get references on two other janpadas, Kuru and Panchal. And Panchal is especially the region of Rohilkhand, and Kuru covered the area including the area of modern Delhi. Then we had Surshen, a very important janpat that covered the region of Mathura. There was another janpada that is known as Matsya Janpada. Its capital was at Viratnagar. We have a very important historical site known as Bairat in the region in Jaipur district, and that is a very significant place in context of archaeology of the Mauryan period. Then we find reference of a very powerful kingdom, and this was the kingdom of Avanti, which had its capital at Ujjain and also at Mahismati, but later on Ujjain became a very very prominent city during 5th century BC, and we get evidences of mud fortification in this particular region, and that might have probably taken place somewhere in between 6th to 5th century BC. Similarly, the kingdoms which were actually been situated in the middle Gangetic plain, very especially Kosala, was a very very prominent, very very powerful janpad like Avanti, and there were many small clan oligarchies which were part of this Mahajanpad. Even we get reference in Buddhist literature that the Shakya Gana was part of the Kosal Mahajanpad, and it has been described Bhagava Pi Kosal Ko, Aham Pi Kosal Ko. Lord Buddha, it is in regard to Lord Buddha that he belonged to Kosal Mahajanpad. So this is a very interesting reference, and it really makes the prominent position of Kosal in then politics very clear to us. Mention can be made of Kasi as a very very important, very significant Mahajanpad of that period, and from later Vedic literature and also some of the early Buddhist Jatakas, it is clear that once Kasi was a very prominent, a very powerful Mahajanpad, and Jain texts also corroborate it. We find reference that Ashwasen was the king of Kasi Mahajanpad, and his son Parshvanath became the 23rd Tirthankara. So, in regard to the Janpad of Kasi, Mahajanpad of Kasi, we find a very interesting reference in then literature. It very clearly describes that Sakala Jambu Dvipa Raja. So, the aspiration even in that period probably was that to become the ruler of entire Jambu Dvipa. This is what literature describes. The second important name in this regard is of course of Angad Janpad, and before the rise of Magad Ang, which had its capital at Champapuri or Champa Nagri, which was situated on the bank of river Champa, its boundary extended up to the region of sea coast, and even before the rise of Magadha, the Magadha was part of the Anga kingdom. Such kind of preferences we find in literature, and Gaya very especially, that has been described as a city in some of the early texts as part of the Anga kingdom. Later on, Gaya became a very important place of the Magadha kingdom. We find in respect to the Kikat one, which was actually the earliest name of Magad that we find in literature, Kikateshu Gaya Punyam Punyam Raj Griham Vanam. So in the entire Kikat one, Gaya was one sacred place, and then the forest of Rajagrih was also very sacred. This has been described. So it is now very clear that all Mahajanpadas were trying to extend their boundaries, and there was a scrambling for power in entire northern India, and there was undoubtedly a quest to become the most powerful monarch at that particular time. In this respect, we have to remember that there were three kingdoms out of these 16 kingdoms were undoubtedly very powerful. Avanti was one kingdom which was very powerful, and it was the largest kingdom at one time, one point of time. It had one advantage to that it explored and quarried the iron of the region of the eastern part of modern day Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh, and they undoubtedly developed good iron tools and weapons which was helping them in organizing their military, and this was probably one of the most important reason that it took 100 years time rise of Magadha as a power that could have easily controlled the Avanti kingdom. The second important power that was there in the region of middle Gangetic plain, and it appears to be the arch rival of Magadha, that was the Kosal Mahajanpad. We find that Kosal was a very rich Mahajanpad, and we get reference of several trading centers. Sravasti was its capital. We have got excavated a place named Sahet Mahet on the boundary of Gonda and Bahraich districts of Uttar Pradesh, where we have got the earliest evidence of mud fortification. It's a very significant evidence. There is no doubt about that Sravasti had emerged as a very important township in its own period. Apart from that, there were two other significant cities. One is Ayodhya, which is just not important in historical context, it is mythologically also very significant, because Ayodhya and the third city, Saket, probably they were two different cities which were not situated very far from each other. Ray Davies had very clearly mentioned that these two cities existed separately. However, there are scholars who believe that Saket is another name of Ayodhya. As far as the etymological meaning of Ayodhya is concerned, means that a city where no war can take place. It is a impregnable city, invincible city. So Kosal was a very, very powerful ruler. We get again references in our literature about the three important kings of that era, means 6th century BC India. One of Chanda, Pradyot, who ruled over the Avanti kingdom. The second important ruler is Bimbisar, who was ruling over Magadha, and in this respect, the name of the king of Kosala, that is also very, very important, that was Prasenjit. So these three rulers have been invariably discussed in Brahmanical text, Buddhist text, and also Jain text. That makes clear that in 6th century BC, during the time of Buddha, these were the three contemporary rulers, and among these three rulers, role of Bimbisar as an administrator and as a diplomat, as a great warrior, that was undoubtedly significant. Before going into details of the Magadhan history, I would like to explain the then geography of Magadha. Slide, please. The Jain geography of Magadha. This is the map that makes clear the geographical areas occupied by the different Mahajanpadas. It is important to know that Magadha of the present time includes districts like Patna, Gaya, Nalanda, Jahanabad, Aurangabad, Arwal. Generally, for these districts, we use the term Magadha. During 6th century BC, initially, Magadha was the land in between the river Champa. Champa was in east to the Magadha. Even Munger was part of the Magadhan kingdom. It was not part of the Anga kingdom. The name that we find is Modagiri. The second important river that we find mentioned in context of Magadha is the Son River. That was towards the west of Magadha. So, Magadha was situated between these two rivers, Champa in the east and then of course Son in the west, and it was in the middle Gangetic plain, which is now part of the districts which we have mentioned, though we belong to Bihar. We can say modern days Patna Commissionary, Magadha Commissionary and some parts of Shahabad Commissionary. These were parts of the, the different regions of the Magadhan kingdom in ancient time. We will have to understand the geography of Magadha in detail to understand the fact that how geography played a very important role in the rise of Magadha. Now, Magadha doesn't have very good number of rivers which actually provide ample of water for agricultural activity in southern part of Bihar. But the rivers which were generally seasonal rivers, they played very significant role in paddy transplantation in this region. And there are rivers, we can see the dry beds of different rivers. Phalgu is very important river, then Dhanarya is one river, Sankari river. These rivers have been, Paimari is another very important river. These rivers flow through Magadha, and they all originate from the hills, the plateau of Chota Nagpur, and flow through Magadha division. Panchanan is a river, Niranjana, Mohana, Phalgu, Panchanan, Dhanarya, Sankari. These all rivers have been mentioned in ancient Buddhist and Jain literature in regard to the journey of Lord Buddha and Mahavira in the kingdom in the region of Magadha. We also get very important reference that there were 80,000 villages in the kingdom of Magadha, and Buddhist literature describe that the villages of Magadha, they were very rich. There were Brahmanas called Babhans, they were very rich. The main description of Grahapatis, we can find that this Grahapati, this name occurs in Buddhist literature many times. And they were householders who were having fabulous wealth, ample of agricultural product, and that had made Magadha very, very significant in terms of its rise as a great economic and political power of that period. Here I would like to mention that it was geography which actually determined the success. In one way, the city named Rajagrih, that was an impregnable city, and it has an excellent Giri Durg. We get reference of Duradharsham Giri, that means the hills of Rajagrih. They were impregnable, that they made the city invincible. And in that respect itself, we find a very interesting reference of the names of different hills: Vaibhargiri, Vaipulyagiri, Varahagiri, Vrishabhagiri, and then Giriek, Ekam. We get references of different hills which covered the region of Rajagrih. The ancient name of Rajagrih, which served as the capital of Magadha for a very long time, was Girivraja. And actually this place was not very far from modern Rajagrih. or it may be the name of the ancient Rajagriha itself. However, there were different Grivrajas in 6th century BC because literature describes Grivraja of Magadha Desha. That means there were other Grivraja, the city named at Grivraja also. So, geography, very especially the denuded mountains and hills, which actually created a kind of a natural fortification around the Magadhan capital, that helped Magadha in creating defense strategy for its own capital. Here I would like to mention that the history of Magadha is described in Puranic literature as well, and this literature is very interesting because we find genealogical history, especially the description of names of kings have been found. In Mahabharata, we find description of the names of various kings of Magadha. It is said that Magadha was founded by Vasu, and this is one reason that Rajagriha itself had been called in ancient literature as Vasu Puri or Vasu Nagar. And then in respect to the dynastic history, the names which is very significant is the name of Vrihadat, and it was after this Vrihadat, for that we don't have much historical account, the capital city of Magadha became famous as Varahadarthapuram. It was named after Vrihadat, who is considered as the founder of the Haranyaka dynasty. This is important to note that Magadha, before it as a political power, who established his control on a larger part of Indian subcontinent, was ruled by four important dynasties. The first important dynasty is Haranyaka dynasty, second important dynasty is Sishunaga dynasty, third important dynasty is Nanda dynasty, and fourth dynasty is the Mauryan dynasty. So, we will go one by one. This dynasty known as Haranyaka dynasty produced several great kings. The name of Jarasandh is sometimes also, it is generally associated with Vrihadat, that Jarasandh was his son, and Mahabharata mentions about Jarasandh, who was ruling over Magadha. As far as the first historical name which is significant in regard to rise of Magadha is undoubtedly Bimbisar. And Bimbisar was a king who adopted the policy of aggressive imperialism and an approach of relentless fighting against different other kingdoms for territorial expansion. His diplomacy is equally very important. And Bimbisar actually evolved a policy of matrimonial alliance, and through the policy of matrimonial alliance, he had been very much successful in positioning himself in entire Middle Gangetic Plain as the most powerful ruler. He was married to the royal, to a girl from the royal family of Kosala, and in dowry he got the kingdom of Kasi. Once the kingdom of Kasi merged into Magadha, the revenue that Magadha was getting from its estate, had remarkably increased, and in that way Magadha got, you know, enough revenue for consolidating army, for making forts, for increasing the number of army. Here I would like to mention that the credit of evolving a proper system of administration also goes to Magadha, and we get reference of three different categories of officials in regard to Magadhan administration. First important name is Golmik. Gulm means a battalion, a contingent of army, and it denotes to the well consolidated military that Magadha was having. Second important term that we find mentioned in ancient literature is Saulkik. that actually denotes to the revenue officers. That means the revenue administration in Magadhan kingdom was also very sound. The third important term that has been made, that is of Vyavaharik, that means judicial administration. So Magadha was one kingdom which developed a very sound system and a very powerful system of administration during its own region. The name of Srenika Bimbisara, or sometimes Seniya Bimbisara, that has been described, it makes clear that Bimbisar was commander in chief of a large consolidated army. This is very clear from our literary references. His son Ajatshatru himself adopted the policy of blood and iron, and he had been remarkably successful in his diplomacy. He was the first Magadhan ruler who decided to make a military garrison at Pataliputra, and Lord Buddha himself had witnessed that on the bank of river Ganga some fortification was being done, some structures were being created, and it was undoubtedly to control one of the most important confederation, the most important confederation of the clan oligarchies, which was known as Vajji Sangh, and its capital was Vaishali. Here I would like to mention that 6th century BC was the period of second urbanization. Koyan economy had already introduced, had evolved, and different cities were emerging. Champapuri, the capital of Anga, was one important city, and then we find reference of Vaishali as an excellent city in Buddhist Vaishali Swargopamam. It was a city that was equated to the heaven Ramyam Manoharam. It was a beautiful city. And similarly, regarding Rajagrih, we find reference that Pashanakam Chaityam Magadhapuram. The city of Magadhapuram, this word Magadhapuram has also been used in ancient literature basically for Rajagrih. And it had many chatyas which were made of Pashan, made of a stone. This is the description that we find. We get some very interesting archaeological evidence also from Vaishali. We have got evidence of mud fort, and then of later period we have many archaeological remains which substantiate the fact that during Mauryan period already Vaishali has emerged a very important site. So it was a rich kingdom, and Ajatshatru was trying to extend its boundary up to the regions of foothills of Himalayas, and for that it was very much required to take some military measures for controlling and subjugating the Vajji Sangh. We know from ancient literature that Sunith and Vasakar, the two actually great ministers of Magad, they played very important role in the growth of Magadhan imperialism, and they had sown the seeds of dissension in the Vajji Sangh, in the Vajji Confederation. This is what literature describes. And so Ajatshatru was very diplomatic. He reoccupied Kashi, developed matrimonial relationship again with Kingdom of Kosala, and then decided to extend the boundary of Magadhan kingdom in the region of North Bihar. Earlier his father Bimbisar had extended the kingdom of Magadha only in the region of what we call Angadesh. So Anga had become already part of Magad, Kashi had become part of Magad. Ajatshatru actually penetrated into the region of the Vajji Sangh, and during his period Magadha established its political control also on Vaishali. This is a very remarkable point, that matrimonial alliance of Magadha played a very, very important role in strengthening their position among the then kings of the middle Gangetic plain, and there remained only very capable, you know, the power which could have challenged the authority of Magadha, that was Avanti. And Avanti was quite far, so Magadha itself didn't involve in itself in military operation. However, it is believed that due to the invasion of Kosala, probably Ajatasatru decided for fortification of Rajagrih, and we have very significant archaeological evidence, to show that important initiative was taken by Ajatasatru for the purpose of fortifying the entire. We can see the archaeological evidence. Cyclopean walls with bastions can be seen even in modern days, Rajgiri, which are very important archaeological evidence of Giri Durga. Durga, the fort that had been created in the hilly region, and this is a just not the evidence of a first major site which was fortified with bastions and cyclopean walls, and which is a very excellent example of the defense fort, a great fort and a fortified city belonging to 6th century BC India. In this respect, we have to understand that how the different dynasties which ruled over Magadha, they were trying to extend their power and establish their suzerainty all over India. We have already discussed about the Haranyak dynasty. This second important dynasty that ruled over Magadha was Sishunag dynasty, and the Sishunag dynasty had two very important, you know, credits in their favor. One, they shifted the capital from Rajgrih to Pataliputra. The strategic geographical location of Pataliputra is a very, very significant thing, very, very important thing. Pataliputra is situated on the confluence of river Ganga, Son, Punpun, Gandak, and little far from Pataliputra, Ghagra also joins it. So, Pataliputra was just not a Wari Durg, a water fort of its own period, which was impregnable, invincible one, crossing all these rivers, perennial rivers, for an invading army. That was very difficult, however, for Pataliputra. Moving towards different nooks and corners of Middle Gangetic plain was easy by using boats. So, this decision that Udayan, the king of Magadha, took to transfer the capital from Rajagrih to Pataliputra was a very pragmatic decision. It was a very important decision that he took. For a very small period of time, even Vaisali served as the capital of Magadha. It's a very important reference. And Kala Ashok ruled from Vaisali. It was just for a very short span of time, but it is indicative to this fact that Vaisali was an important center, and by capturing Vaisali, by establishing Magadhan political paramountacy over the kingdom of Vaisali and Videha, it became easier for Magadhan ruler to control Mallas of Kushinara to the different oligarchic republics of the foothill regions of region, and in that way it Magadha had been able to capture a larger part of the region of the Koshal Mahajanpad, it larger part of the region of this Malla kingdom, and entire North Bihar was brought under the control of the Magadha kingdoms. This has made the position of Magadha very powerful in the politics of 5th-4th century BC India. I had already explained it, that it took almost 100 years in giving a befitting reply to the invading army of the Avanti kingdom, and Magadha inflicted a crushing defeat on the Avanti kingdom, and this played a very vital role in the rise of Magadha, which extended its political boundary right from the region of Anga kingdom up to the region of Avanti kingdom. Next slide, please. We will can see how Magadha has been able to manage it. We have already discussed that Magadha, this first capital, was a hilly city, and we can see the slide of Rajgrih, the hills of Rajgrih, and the vegetation on the hill. It was a beautiful city, and we find different names: Vardhatpuram, Vasupuri, Magadhpuram, and different other names have been described. One thing which is very important in geographical context is that Magadha was a place which was very fertile. The land of Magadha was highly fertile because of alluvium. The alluvial of Ganga and other rivers, which was spread over the entire South Bihar, it was having very good rainfall also in that region, and the soil of Magadha is always capable to contain moistureness for a longer time. These were some of the important factors which were responsible for agricultural surplus in the region of Magadha, and especially by using iron tools for agricultural activities, the peasants of Magadha ensured the surplus production in this particular region. And once this rice production was very high, Magadha became very rich, just not in terms of agricultural production and not only in terms of production of rice. Here we must remember the etymological meaning of dhana. The word dhana, which is used for paddy and dhanya, somebody who is having dhanya or dhana in great quantity became a dhani person, means a rich person. And it was rice which was used for giving salary even to the people, or a share to the people in the total agricultural production. That strengthened the revenue system of the Magadha, because before evolution of coin economy, probably it was the rice for that. The term bhakta, bhakta means to divide, this term bhakta had been, and the modern word bhatta, which is used for bonus, we still use this term bhatta for bonus, that was in form of redistribution of rice. Salary was given in terms of rice before the emergence of the coin economy, evolution of coinage in the region of Magadha. So iron technology, rise of growth of agricultural surplus, these were some of the very important factors. We must remember that use of iron was playing very instrumental role, just not in strengthening Magadhan army. Another very significant thing was that it played important role in introduction of coinage system also. We have very good number of punch marked coins which belong to Magadha and Kosal region, and they are made of silver. Literature describes kaharpan. Kaharpan is a term that has been used for punch marked coins of the region of Magadha and Kosal. Then they became popular. These coins were used in other regions also, but the credit of introducing early punch mark coins goes to Magadha and Kosal. There have been reports from the region of Jahanabad that there have been found a good number of punch mark coins. So the silver coins, introduction of silver coins, had given a boost to the economy, and it played very dynamic role in the economic development of the region. One thing is very remarkable, that by using iron not for the purpose of agricultural tools and for the purpose of making different weapons, iron played very powerful role, very pivotal role in emergence and growth of different crafts, because different kinds of tools, equipment which were made of iron, they were quite effective. So carpentry had well developed, and we get reference that Magadhan army was even having large size chariots. So then we find reference of patroon, which was textile which was being produced in the Magadha region. So Magadha region, Champa was a city which was well known for its craft trade, and it was undoubtedly one of the most richest trading centers of Middle Gangetic Plain in its own region. So the use of iron technology was very significant in respect to the rise of Magadha. We must always remember this very fact, that elasticity in social behavior, that was also a very significant. Next slide, please. Elasticity in social behavior was a very significant point. Here you can see the paddy being produced in the region of Magadha. Till this date, despite this fact that peasants of that region don't use good amount of fertilizer, the paddy production in this region is still very high. So this can be understood on the basis of the very lush greenery that we can see. So production of paddy was one important factor, but then elasticity in social behavior, that is a very, very significant point. It was Magadha where Brahmins had taken recourse to military service. This is an amazing fact, that who are supposed to be ritualists, they played important role in agricultural development, and they had participated in active politics. We find a reference of Sunit, Vasakar, Saktar and Chanakya playing important role in the Magadhan politics. And secondly, we find that even a son of a Dashik could have aspired to become king of Magadha, and he became king of Magadha. Then a bar, the throne of Magadha was also not beyond the reach of a poor barber. So this shows the elasticity of the behavior of the people who were living in the Magadha. It was a society that evolved a kind of composite culture, where belonging to the family of Rajakula, that was not only important. In this regard, the reference of the Nanda dynasty, it is a very significant example. They claim that they use the epithet of Sarva Chhatrantak, means one who defeated all the Kshatriya rulers. And the Nandas belong to the so-called lower origin, but then they became paramount rulers. And Mahapadvananda is a glorious name in the history of Magadha, and his credit goes for consolidating the army of Magadha. And when Alexander was planning for penetrating in Magadhan region, he came to know about the huge army, 2 lakh of infantry, 6,000 elephants, then charioteers, and 6,000 cavalrymen. So this was a well consolidated, a very powerful army that Magadha was having. Here I would like to mention that Magadha was the first kingdom that used elephant as tanks in the battlefield, and elephants had the great ability to cross the marshy land, and they were able to carry a lot of weapon, and entire commissariat department probably was also dependent on very strong elephantry that Magadha was having. And the credit of using elephant for the purpose of war actually goes to Magadha. The Magadhan, we will have to appreciate the pretentious mind of the politicians and military men of the Magadhan kingdom. They were just not relentless fighters. They evolved a new weaponry system, and we find reference of Mahasila Kantak and also Rath Mushal, which was used by the kings of Magadha in the battlefield. and Rath Musal was especially the use of mace, heavy stone mace with chariot that could was actually able enough to destroy the chariots of the enemy. Similarly, the Asma Chakra, we also get reference, and Mahasila Kantak hurling a stone, large pieces of stone in the battlefield to terrify the invading army or the army of the enemy was made possible by this machine, probably a wooden catapult that was used with great efficacy by the Magadhan military commander. And this is undoubtedly one of the significant reasons that Magadhan dominated in all the important affairs of war and politics of that particular period. There is no doubt about that it was the strength of the Magadhan army that the Alexander and his army men decided not to penetrate into the boundary of Magadha. Here is a very significant point that I would like to discuss, that Magadha is not only important in context of its military strength, its a spirit of bravery, its dauntless courage, its indomitable gallantry. Magadha is also important in context of very sound system of administration.
We will discuss it, but before that we have a caller from Gujarat. So let us take question. Good afternoon friends, please ask your question.
Mujhe puchha tha ki Ganga Magadha ki riva
hai. Ji, sawal puchhiye. मैं माफ करेंगे, मैं दर्शकों से अनुरोध करूंगा कि सवाल पूछने के पहले कृपया अपना टीवी का वॉल्यूम कम कर लें, उसके बाद सवाल पूछें।
मुझे वो प्रश्न पूछना।
जी, अब सवाल पूछिए। आपकी आवाज नहीं है, कंटिन्यू करें सर, आवाज में डिस्टर्बेंस कुछ।
मैं क्षमा प्रार्थी हूँ, आवाज में डिस्टर्बेंस है। नेक्स्ट स्लाइड, मगधन एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन, नेक्स्ट स्लाइड, मगधन एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन प्लेड वेरी वेरी सिग्निफिकेंट रोल एंड ए काइंड ऑफ सेंट्रलाइज्ड ब्यूरोक्रेसी दैट हैज बीन इवॉल्व ड्यूरिंग दिस पीरियड एंड वन वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट, यू कैन सी द क्वाइंस, द पंचमार्क क्वाइन विथ सडर अंग and the was and various symbols. It's a numismatical study of this period is equally very important. Very large number of coins were issued by the Magadha kingdom. It's not denotative to this fact that market economy was well developed. It is also a significant source to understand the Magadhan administration. And as Arthashastra describes, that belongs to Mauryan period, that the bureaucracy, especially the people who are working for the government, for the Magadhan administration, they were paid in cash, they were paid in form of kasharpan. So I would like to encapsulate the different factors. Once again, the geography of Magadha was very conducive, is played a very important role in the growth of Magadhan kingdom as a powerful state. It is significant to note that the fertile land added with good rainfall and then use of iron which was available in the region of modern day Jharkhand, that has been of course inseparable part of the ancient Magadha, that was used by the Magadhan kings for different purposes. And the use of iron was not only important in context of rise of Magadha as a military power, it played very pivotal role in development of art and craft and even in the evolution introduction of coinage system in the Magadha. So these were some of the physical, geographical and economic factor. However, I would like to appreciate the Magadhan diplomacy and the art of warfare and the weaponry system that they evolved, which made their success possible. And this was how Magad emerged as the most powerful kingdom in entire Indian subcontinent. In next lecture, we will discussing about some other aspects of Magadhan political power and how it reached its apex during the Mauryan period.
Okay, so through the lecture, we gather that there were so many aughts and the Magadhan kings were with the ruler of the time, they overcome it. So, what was, how you assess in the given period of time, that time and present, what was the special traits of the ruler of that period?
You know,
because there are 16 Mahajanpada, they all were capable to do this, but it was only a geographical condition that paved the way for the rise of Magad. Yeah, it was the special test that the Magadhan ruler possessed that finally led them to victory.
Yes, I have already described that a Magadhan diplomacy that has been very much important. We know from Buddhist texts that Sunitha and Vasakar, and later on Shaktar, Rakshasamat and Chanakya, very capable, you know, ministers, they were playing very crucial role. Maha Amatyas of Magadha, they were playing very important role in then diplomacy. And Ajatasatru, who was one of the most prominent names in his own period, he was known even to the Gandhara kingdom and people of the Madhradesha as a powerful ruler. This Ajatasatru used with great efficacy not only his diplomatic policy, the policy of matrimonial alliance which was evolved by his father, also had sown seeds of dissension in the kingdom of Vaishali, which was confederation of 10 oligarchic republics. Then the initiative that he took for fortification of Rajgrih city, Rajgrih, which that was the capital. Then it is also important that they created a consolidated army. Then they thought for developing a proper administrative system. We have talked about the Shalkik, Golmik and Vyavaharik, the three different departments of the government which were very effectively working in the region of Magad. So credit goes actually not only to natural resources and conducive geographical conditions. Avanti was also having enough iron. Koshala was also a rich kingdom, but it was basically the success of the dauntless courage, bravery and you can say the statesmanship, the acumen, political acumen of the Magadhan rulers.
That finally laid the foundation for
yes,
the…
Yes, of course.
And one thing, the matrimonial alliance were also under, adopted that time. So, what do you think, because when we go through the Magad to the Mughal ruler, these have been followed vigorously by the rulers. So, it was a foresight, we can say that Magadhan ruler had of the period.
There is no doubt that matrimonial alliance worked as a bedrock for the foundation of the empire of Magadha, because Kasi as a kingdom, I have given already example, that was merged into Magadha. It was given by Kosala to Magadha as a dowry. And you can imagine Kasi once was a very powerful kingdom. Before the rise of Magadha, Kasi was one of the strongest kingdom. And the revenue of Kasi region that was added to Magadha. So, it was a great advantage for Magad, and then it managed support of people of different kingdoms by having matrimonial alliance with Kosala. Mm-hmm. They have created an alliance, and it was because of this region the king of Avanti couldn't dare to penetrate in that region. So, okay. Similar situation was there in Mughal kingdom, and Akbar decided to enter into matrimonial alliance with Rajputs. Mm-hmm. It had benefited the Mughal empire. We know that Bhagwan
so
Das
the
and Mans.
Question arises here, why Kosala gave this Kasi region with so many revenue earning tract was there?
Kasi was also situated, was also in Middle Gangetic Plain. The region was very fertile, and you can understand this Sai River, modern Sai River, the plain of Ghagra and Sarju, the region of Banaras and Allahabad, they were also fertile. Of course, Allahabad region was not as fertile as the region of Magad, but Kasi was close to Magad.
Okay.
And it was also in Gangetic plain. And Kasi has been described as a city of trade and multiple crafts. It is what was undoubtedly the richest city of its own period. It was a great trading center. So once Kasi merged into Magad, you can understand that Magadha got a city which was known to entire northern India for its excellent craftsmanship and business.
Okay. So, well, friends, I hope today's lecture must have benefited you. Tomorrow we'll discuss the more dimension of the rise of Magad. So with these words, we conclude the lecture. I thank all of you for watching the lecture. And on our behalf, I thank Dr. Anand Bardhan for giving such a wonderful lecture on this very topic. Thank you very much.
Thank you.